Hi all, it's Rachel from TRMR Farms, and today I want to talk about misleading advertising. But before we get started, I just have to say that I just dropped this like half full thing of fermented cod liver oil out of my refrigerator and broke it, and I'm very sad because it's not cheap and obviously I can't eat it with shards of glass in it, and I wanted to share that with someone who would understand. So let's all just have a moment and be sad for my fermented cod liver oil gel. Fermented cod liver oil tragedies aside, I just want to talk about misleading advertising real quick. So I can't really necessarily say it's false advertising because technically everything that you're going to see on these labels is true. But even though it's technically and more importantly legally true, it doesn't mean that it's really the best representation of the product or that it's not misleading to the consumer potentially. So I just have a few things here. I wanted to go through them. Just things that I kind of like have noticed walking around the grocery store and stuff like that, and things that in particular bug me a little bit. So I just chose a few items. Obviously, this is a really big rabbit hole and you could spend a lot of time going all the way down it and looking at all of the different advertising tricks of the trade and stuff that they use to get your money, because that's what advertisers want. They want to make a product, advertise it to you, and get you to buy it so that they get their money. And that's not a bad thing. You know, everybody who makes something, I make things sometimes and want to sell them. So obviously you want to put it forward in its best light so that people want to buy it. I get it, and that's, you know, that's fine. That's just how advertising works. But I think there's a fine line between putting forward your product in its best lighting and just kind of like using tricks to fool people into buying something that they're thinking is kind of one thing when really it's kind of another thing. And I also understand that part of it is your responsibility as a consumer and my responsibility as a consumer to have the buyer beware kind of attitude and to research and become knowledgeable about these things so that you are understanding what you're seeing on the labels. But obviously not everybody can do that or wants to do that or is going to do that. So I just wanted to point out the tricks that they use so that you could be aware of them if you weren't already. And I know a lot of you probably are, but if you are, maybe you can share this video with friends who aren't aware of the tricks and then they can learn from it as well. So let's get started. So I'll just grab the first one that always aggravates me. Looking at this nice ocean spray bottle of juice, it says 100% juice, cranberry, no sugar added. That sounds good, right? That sounds like it's cranberry juice. Now, why would you want to buy cranberry juice other than just to drink it for fun? One reason that people will buy cranberry juice is because it's very helpful for your urinary tract, and it can be helpful if you have a urinary tract infection or that kind of thing. If that is the case, it's really super important that you only have 100% cranberry juice if that is why you're drinking it. Sugar, as you may know, feeds infection. So if you're drinking a juice that has a high sugar content, even if it's a natural sugar that's coming from the fruit, it's gonna actually feed the infection, and the cranberry juice is not gonna work the way that it should as if it were pure cranberry. And if you ever had pure cranberry juice, you know it's very, very tart. It's a fruit with a low natural sugar content in it, whereas other fruits like grape and apple especially is a very sweet juice that has a high natural sugar content. So one day I sent my mom to the store. Well, I didn't send her to the store. She went to the store because she had a urinary tract infection. She had a UTI, and I told her, okay, you need to go get some cranberry juice while you're at the store. And I told her, you know, just be sure that it's 100% cranberry juice. Cran grape, cran apple will not help you. So she came home, and I don't remember if it was this brand, but she had something like this. And I went to inspect it because I knew about the tricks that they kind of pull. And lo and behold, it was a fruit cocktail. Now, looking at this, would you think that it's a fruit cocktail? I personally would not immediately think that this was a fruit cocktail looking at it, because it says 100% juice, and right underneath it, it says cranberry. The picture on the front is nothing but cranberries. So obviously the casual person walking through the grocery store who wants to pick up cranberry juice is gonna think that this is pure cranberry juice, especially when they see that nice no sugar added. However, if you read the fine print down at the bottom that no one ever really looks at, it says blend of 4 juices from concentrate with added ingredients. So that means that this is in fact not 100% cranberry juice. Now the label did not lie, because the label just says 100% juice and then it puts cranberry underneath it. So it does not say that it's 100% cranberry juice, and that's why legally it's not a lie, it's not false, but it's very misleading. And I don't really know why juice companies do that, particularly with cranberry juice, because to me it seems like, what is the point? Are you trying to target people who want to drink cranberry juice for their health and the health of their urinary tract and trick them into buying a juice that's cut with cheaper juices, maybe? I don't know. I don't really see the benefit of it. I don't know why they can't just say that it's a fruit blend, but that's what they do. So if we look back on the ingredients, we will see that it has cranberry juice, but it also has grape juice, it has apple juice, it has pear juice, and then it has natural flavors, pectin and ascorbic acid, which is vitamin C. So pear juice, grape juice, and apple juice are all very sweet juices. They're fruits with a very high sugar content, which is why they're used in cranberry, because it's cutting that tartness from the cranberry that a lot of people can't stomach just because it's so tart. I don't like drinking it either, but it is very good for you. But that's why they're putting pear, apple, and what was the other one? Grape in it, because even though it'll have the cranberry flavor, it has the sugars from those. And that also lets them say that there's no sugar added, because they're not adding any sugar. It's all from fruit, but the fruit has natural sugars. So this has, in one serving, 28 grams of sugar, 28 carbohydrates. So it may not have any added sugars, but the fruit juices that they added have a high sugar content. So this, to me, even though the label is technically honest, it's not representing the product as it is. So that's one of the things you really have to look out for. Read the fine print, read the ingredients list, because there's a lot of ways to say something in a way that makes it look like it's something different. The next item I picked up here is whipped butter. I did not pick this up because I have a problem with whipped butter, because I don't. The ingredients on this are, where are they? They're on the top. And it's just pasteurized sweet cream and salt, which is what anybody who makes butter out of. It's cream, and you can choose to salt it or not. Now it is pasteurized, which if you're like me, I prefer raw milk, but right now I don't have any access to raw milk, so we do what we can. But the reason I got this is because I could not bring myself to buy margarine, because margarine is a fake food, and I feel like everybody knows that margarine is a fake food, and this, you know, butter spread stuff is actually made of vegetable oil from plants that aren't really oily and don't naturally have a high fat content, and it's hydrogenized and all that, but I won't get into all the details because I feel like pretty much everybody knows that margarine is fake, and if they're choosing to eat it, it's either because they believe that it's better for them, even though they know that it's not really a real food, which is a whole nother argument for another day, or they just like don't care because they like the texture. And that's why when I saw this, I was like, hey, I'm gonna pick this up, because even though this isn't technically like mislabeled or misleading or anything, I wanna show this as another option for another food group like margarine. So if you like margarine, because it's so much easier to spread. So you do have other options, and that is whipped butter, because this is gonna be a lot easier to spread, but it's not fakey crap like margarine. And I did notice one thing on it though that again I think is just a little bit misleading. So it says 45% less fat. First of all, fat is not the enemy, but that's another discussion for another day. And per serving than regular butter. Okay, that's not false, that's true, I'll give them that. However, the reason that this is 42% less fat per serving is because they're doing the serving size based on volume, which is 1 tablespoon, And there's about 32 servings in here, but this has been whipped. That means it has air whipped into it. So the reason why a tablespoon of this has less fat than a tablespoon of regular butter is because it's less butter. It's just less butter in it. It has more air content. So you're saying like, oh, we've magically made butter have less fat. No, it's actually just less butter that's easier to spread. So I thought that was a little bit misleading as well because there's nothing about this. It's just butter that they whipped and made lighter and more airy by inserting air into it. Hey y'all, it's Rachel from the future, and I had to come back and insert something that I thought about later about butter. So I've got my butter back out of the fridge to talk about it. And it occurred to me late at night as I was falling asleep that they're saying like this has 45% less fat, but butter is literally just fat. Like, it's just fat. It's literally the congealed or extracted fat particles out of milk. So why are we trying to take our literal fat and make it less fat? Like, butter is just solidified fat molecules. I don't get it. Butter's a fat, guys.
Is butter a carb? Yes.
And fat is not the enemy as long as it's a healthy fat that comes from a real source, like actual milk and not hydrogenized vegetable oils and crap like that. So I just think it's funny. Just eat your butter, folks. Just eat your butter. Okay, next thing is these organic bananas. Now, this is not misleading, just offhand. It's just an organic banana. But the one reason that I wanted to bring up organic is because there is like just a misconception about organic in general. And that is that if it's organic, it's not sprayed. If it's organic, they use no chemicals. If it's organic, they were all, you know, if they're animals, they were all pastured. None of that is true. Organic just means that they held up to USDA organic standards. One misconception that people have about organic is that it's not sprayed with any chemicals. And again, that is not true. There are fungicides, herbicides, and insecticides, which kill fungus, weeds, and insects, that are compatible that you can use with organic crops. So just because it says it's organic does not mean it has not been sprayed with a chemical. It just means that it's been sprayed with a chemical that's on the okay list as a chemical that can be considered organic. I won't go into all of that because I don't really understand all the ins and outs of why some are on the organic list and some are not and all that. But the thing is, if it's an insecticide, it doesn't matter if it's organic or not, it kills bugs. If it's a fungicide, it doesn't matter if it's organic or not, it kills fungus. If it's a herbicide, it doesn't matter if it's organic or not, it kills weeds. So even if it's saying it's organic, that doesn't necessarily mean that the farmer did not spray his crops. The next one is these Back to Nature Fudge Mint cookies. And I just picked these up because these are not in any way falsely advertised. But this was to point out that even though it's non-GMO verified and the ingredients are not that bad, it's like sugar, palm oil, cocoa flour, soy lecithin. I'm not crazy about that. If you don't know, soy is a phytoestrogen. It's not actually that great for you. And it is in everything. And usually soy is GMO, but this is certified non-GMO. So supposedly we can trust that it's not. But soy, whole milk powder, unbleached wheat flour, dried cane syrup, aka sugar, palm oil, cocoa processed with alkali, dried cane invert syrup, sugar, baking soda, sea salt, soy lecithin again, I don't know why it's there twice, and peppermint oil. So aside from the soy, it's not that bad, but I brought these, and actually they tasted good too, I've already eaten some of them, but the problem is that people see things like this and they think, oh, it says back to nature and it's non-GMO and it doesn't have, you know, let's see, fake stuff in it and it's sustainable and the cardboard is recyclable and all that. And those are all good things. And it does make things like this a potentially better option than other brands. Again, be sure to always read the ingredients and things like that, because it could just be misleading packaging and the ingredients could all be the same as the next thing that's cheaper. But we tend to look at these, and I'm guilty of that too, and thinking, oh, this is healthier, so I can eat it, and I won't have, like, there will be no repercussions from eating all of these cookies, even though they're still cookies. And that was my point with this, is like, you can't get so absorbed in, you know, being a healthy brand or a healthier option and think that that inherently makes the food healthy, because at the end of the day, these are still cookies. So that's something that I am guilty of, falling into the trap of like, well, I'm gonna get these cookies, but they're gonna be good cookies and it's gonna be better for me. But it's still like, if you're like me and you're trying to lose weight and diet, it's still a cookie. So we do have to keep that in mind, that it may be a better cookie than some of the other options, but at the end of the day, it's still a cookie. This one is my personal favorite, and yes, I did buy a dozen eggs, even though we get plenty of our own eggs that are very beautiful and very tasty and have beautiful dark yolks, but I bought these for the label. So there is a whole hot mess going on here to talk about. And again, this is not anything negative about this brand or anything like that. It's just typical advertisements. You'll see it on basically any egg brand you buy and stuff like that. So, cage-free. Okay. Cage-free means that they are not in battery hen cages. That's a good thing. However, it does not mean that they are roaming the green pasture sides. So a lot of people see free range or they see cage-free and they envision these chickens out on green grass and stuff like that. That is not the case. They can still be in an enclosed barn and they can still not have any access to pasture or grass. And they're cage-free because they're not kept in cages. So that's one thing to be aware of. Cage-free and free-range does not necessarily mean what you think it means. If you really want pastured eggs, either buy eggs that are labeled pastured, or better yet, find a farmer or a homesteader that you know that will sell you eggs, like we sell to some people because we have extras. So that does not mean what you think it means. Probably. Depends on how knowledgeable you are. And it's not bad to like not understand this, because that's how these advertisement works, is that most people don't understand what it means really. Grain fed, that just means that the feed they're fed is grain. Literally every chicken ever, my chickens, the biggest farm in the country's chickens, they're fed grain. I don't know why that matters. So talks about how it's a source of vitamin E and fatty acids. That's fine. Now, it does say large brown eggs, which these are brown eggs, so that's not a false advertisement or anything like that, but for some reason, a lot of people associate brown eggs with being healthier or even tasting better, and there's nothing wrong with liking the brown ones better, but I've even seen them marked up to a higher price in grocery stores for brown eggs and white eggs. One reason for that is that typically your brown egg layers lay less than your white egg layers, because your white egg layers are leghorns. And white leghorns lay more than any other breed of chicken. They are the highest production chicken, so it costs less to feed them and get more eggs. So maybe that's why the brown eggs are more expensive, because per chicken and per the amount of feed that that chicken is eating, they're getting less eggs out of it. But these are not any healthier than a white egg of the same quality. What makes the eggs healthy is what goes into the chicken, which should ideally be grass and bugs and things like that, along with their regular food. The color of the egg is just the outside. It's just basically the color ink that the chicken uses in her printer when she makes the egg. So it varies by breed. Some breeds lay brown eggs, some breeds lay white eggs, some lay pinkish colored eggs, some lay white or cream eggs. I think I already said white. Some lay blue eggs, some lay green eggs, some lay olive eggs, some lay really dark brown eggs. So it's just up to the breed and the individual chicken. The one thing on here that I think is just the most silly is that, well, actually no, there are two things on here I think are the most silly. One is that they are vegetarian fed. That's fine and dandy. The only problem with that is that chickens are not vegetarians. They're just not vegetarians, and they are omnivores just like us, only obviously they're not hunting anything larger than a grasshopper. Although occasionally they will catch a mouse and eat a mouse too, or even a small snake. They will sometimes kill and eat a small snake or mouse or something like that. Don't buy into the vegetarian fed chicken thing. And the last thing on here that really, really irks me that I see on a lot of different things, you'll see it on chicken meat, you'll see it on eggs, you'll see it on pork, and that is the no hormones line. That eggs do not contain added hormones, chicken's not fed added hormones, yada, yada, yada. Again, the only problem with that is that it's not legal to feed chickens hormones. There is no approved hormone to be fed to chickens. There is no approved hormone to be fed to pigs. The only animal in the U.S., at least, I don't know about other countries, but the only animal in the U.S. that can legally be given growth hormone is a cow. So if it's on beef or dairy that they were not fed added hormones or didn't have a hormone, any additional hormones given to them, that's valid. If it's on chicken or pork or eggs or fish or anything else like that, it is a marketing ploy to make you want to buy it and make you think that it's so much better than the competitor when there is not a single chicken in the United States being given any kind of hormone, nor are there any pigs in the U.S. legally being given any kind of hormone. Only cattle can be given hormones. It's the only one that hormones are approved for. I don't want hormones in my food. I don't want phytoestrogens in my food. That's why I don't eat a lot of soy. That's why none of my livestock are fed soy. And obviously I'm not going to be giving added hormones, growth hormones and things to my cows to make them grow faster, because that's not what I'm about. But it really, really bugs me when I see advertisers use the hormone-free advertisement on something that could never have hormones in the first place. People need to understand where the food comes from and, you know, form their own opinions about it, but they have to have the truth in order to be able to do that. So that's why I wanted to do this video, because things like this, they're very misleading, and I just don't think that it's fair to the consumer to not have the full information and to understand some of the little tricks of the trade that advertisers use to make you think that their food is so much better than the competitors, when maybe it's really not that different to begin with. Anyway, thank you for watching. I hope that this helped you maybe learn a few things you didn't know about advertisements and food labels and stuff like that. And thank you for watching. You can follow me on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. I'm at Terramar Farms, all of those places, and I'll see y'all next time.